sits on the throne. All who behold him sing, holy are you. None can compare to all that you are. Heaven and earth, we sing, holy are you. Here we lay our crowns before.
Here we go.
Philippians 4, verse
6 and 7. Do not be anxious
about anything,
but in every situation,
I pray
and petition
with thanksgiving.
Present your request to God.
And the peace of God,
which transcends all
understanding,
will guard
your
heart
and
your mind in Christ Jesus.
Hey Harvest, wow, what an amazing scripture to encourage us all on this special time we're having. I know it's lockdown, but wow, I've been enjoying the services. Look, it's not as nice as being with you all in the beautiful church hall we have, but it's been so special, and thanks to all of those that were part of making that amazing, amazing scripture. You realize that unity is so important, and even just the upfront part of this service has used more than 40 people to get it going. So what an amazing thought. Even though every one of those people is separated, all because of the word, they're together. So I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. So let's just dedicate this time to the Lord. Father, we just thank you. We thank you that you are a good God. We thank you, Father God, that you always go before us in all that happens. And even in the same way, I pray that no matter what time we're watching this service in our houses, that Lord, you would go before each of us, prepare our hearts for worship, and prepare our hearts to receive your word today. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we know that you're probably comfortable in your own home now, and it's time where we're gonna just worship the Lord together. So let's enjoy this time together. Amen.
Hello family, welcome to our service. Let's all just get together and praise Jesus wherever you're at, in your homes. Gather everybody around, let's do this. Here we go.
I was buried beneath my shame, and who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb, yeah, till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Oh. Let's sing it out. Now your mercy has saved my soul. Your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name.
Come on, shout it out.
And I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious.
Here we go.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you love me, a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. with holy thunder, who leaves its breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on, let's sing it out.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worship today, Father God, go up as a sweet offering before your throne, God, this morning. Give you all the praise, God.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper.
It was just such an amazing time of worship together. And just to think that while you've been worshiping in your house or in your bedroom, wherever you've been, everyone from our Harvest family has been worshiping with you. And not just here in PE, but even people from around the world have been saying they've been loving joining us in our services. So it's been an amazing time. Thank you, everyone. This is the time of service where we usually would hand out the baskets for the offering. And obviously we can't do that now. But you'll see on screen, there's a couple of ways you're able to make your payments for your tithe or your offering. We want to encourage you in this time. It is tough, but know that as we give, we're giving into His hands, into Jesus' hands. And so when you do it, I want to encourage you, don't just do it, don't just pay it, but take a moment to pray over what you're giving and know that you're giving it into Jesus' hands and for His work. And so as you do that, I want to pray a blessing over the offering. Father, thank you. thank you for every faithful giver. We thank you that as we give, we're actually giving into your kingdom. And as we give into the kingdom, so many people are able to be helped. And we pray that people won't just receive food and help through this time through what we've given through the church, but Father, that people would realize and know that it's come from you, and that people would know that they can have a relationship with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Thanks for that harvest. We're going to be going right into the time now where we're going to receive a word, and not just a word in season. And I pray that it would be a word that encourages you. So go get your pen and notebook, get ready. Even if you need to press pause quickly, do it. But don't you want to take notes and just write down what you think God is saying to you today in this message. So over to Mark.
Father, as we spend time in your word today, I want to pray that you would customize this message by your Holy Spirit. You would customize this message for every hearer. But Lord, each and every one of us would receive what you want us to receive today. You would speak what you need to speak into our hearts today. And we would leave this time together knowing that you've been with us and you've spoken to us and you've ministered to us. You've encouraged us. You've exhorted us. And you've reaffirmed the path we're on. Or you've helped us to find course correction so that we can get onto the right path. But whatever you have to do, would you do it today by your Holy Spirit, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome, everyone. My message today is called Togetherness. And togetherness is defined as the state of being close to another person or other people. So why am I talking about togetherness at a time when we're not allowed to physically be with each other? You can't even visit your parents or your grandparents if they stay in another home, let alone attend church or connect group. So I'm talking about all of this and this concept of togetherness because we will meet again. Although it will be phased in, we'll meet again, perhaps first only in connect groups and then later on the big gatherings will come again, but we will meet again. I'm talking about togetherness because when life eventually does go back to normal and when life gets busy again, and when we get back to juggling all the many priorities we have, we must not forget what it was like to not be able to gather as the saints. And gathering with other believers must be a priority. When we're juggling our priorities again, gathering with other saints must be a priority. Humans have an amazing ability to bounce back. I remember when we were at university, we would work hard and be stressed, and then we would write these exams, and then the very next day we would almost forget how difficult it was. We'd be like, oh, it wasn't that bad, and we would just carry on with life. Meanwhile, it was very bad. It was very hectic. And for many, this pandemic, the impact of it's going to be affecting their lives for many years to come. But for many, life's going to go back to normal, and we're going to bounce back. I want to ask that when we bounce back, let us not bounce back to a place of complacency in meeting together. We need to be together. These trying and these unprecedented, these abnormal times have taken their toll on all of us, some way more than others. And just this week, I was praying about what to share today, and I realized something. I realized that something's missing from my walk with the Lord. I'm up to date with my Bible reading plan. I've spent time with the Lord, but there's still something missing. And there's this hole in my heart. There's this gap in my spiritual life. And what's missing is you, my church family. More specifically, what's missing is the personal and physical proximity I need with my church family. See, God's designed us to need each other. I'm not just talking about the need for human interaction that every human needs. I'm talking about the intentional gathering of the saints to pray together, to worship together, to hear the preached word together, and to minister to each other. I'm talking about that. You see, I always knew that it was absolutely essential that we be with other believers, and that we do not neglect the gathering of the saints. I knew all that. But because I've never have neglected the gathering of the saints, for all my Christian life, in fact, I've never truly understood how important it really was. See, I took for granted the gathering of the saints, which is a good thing, because I was doing what the Bible commanded me to do. But in another way, I didn't truly understand the importance of it until now, until it was taken away. And so when we are able to meet again, I know I will not take the gathering of the saints for granted ever. And I know you won't either. Gathering of the saints is a biblical command. I'm going to read that scripture just a little bit later, but I believe that the Bible, as we do at Harvest, is the fully inspired word of God, and we cannot ignore any part of it. You see, you ignore God's word at your peril, your present peril, your future, and your eternal peril. And so you cannot ignore the gathering of the saints. You do that at your peril. There is a strong, strong biblical mandate that we live in a state of togetherness with other believers. In fact, I'll show you from the Bible just a little bit later that when we abandon togetherness, we run the risk of actually falling away from the Lord. So we park that thought. I'm going to come back to it. But this state of togetherness of the believers, it kicked off in a very real and probably a very chaotic way, right in Acts 2. And we're going to read from Acts 2 now. Now we're going through Acts at the moment in our church-wide Bible reading plan. I'm going to jump to just after Peter preached at Pentecost, and I'm going to read from Acts 2. Read with me from verse 41. It says, "Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all." Now, the New Living Translation gives a heading, and it says, "The believers form a community." I love that heading. This next section of Scripture, they put under the heading, "The believers form a community." Now, I want you to notice that in verse 41, it's just said that 3,000 people were added to the church. And then in verse 42, just after that, it says this. Read with me. "All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, and to sharing of meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer." So we're talking about the 3,000 that just got added, plus whoever came out of the upper room. And then it goes on to say in verse 43, "A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miracles and signs and wonders, and all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had." Don't you just love that? "They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved." This was the first mega church, by the way, over 3,000 people. You hear people saying, "Well, God never intended church to get so big." Well, this one was big. This one was big. It was so big that they had to gather in the temple in order to worship together. They were so big they had to gather together in the temple so that the apostles could minister to them. But it also says that they met house to house. And so that's why at Harvest we believe in gathering in the big meetings like we have in the past and like we will again. It's why we believe that we also need to meet in homes and connect groups like we have in the past and like we will again. This is God's model. Temple courts and house to house. Attending church on Sunday and connect group in the week is not a man-made idea. This has always been God's idea. Listen, I want to say this on behalf of the leadership team, and I know they will agree with me. On behalf of all of us, I want to say that we did not give up our careers to do something that was a man-made idea. We have given our lives to help facilitate God's family at Harvest walk out life together. We are meant to stay connected in church life. You are not meant to do this on your own. And when you're in isolation, you have a target on your back. Let me rather say, when you're in self-inflicted isolation, in other words, when you choose to isolate yourself from believers, the current situation is not self-inflicted, it's temporary. You didn't choose it. I'm talking about when you choose to not be part of a church community. So what happens is, in normal life, we are surrounded by unbelievers at work, at school, at university, in the shopping malls. And if you spend enough time in those environments, and we all have to, but you start to feel like you're alone in your faith. But when you gather together, when you take time to gather in your week with other like-minded believers, you're reminded that you're not alone. You're not crazy to believe what you believe. And once you've been encouraged and strengthened, your light shines bright again, you can go out and be the light again in the world. But you need to come together with other believers to be reminded of who you're serving, why you're doing it, and that you're not going crazy. The easiest way to light a candle is to light it off one that's already burning. Have you ever tried to make one match carry to all the different candles you're trying to light? It's quite difficult. But when you have one candle that's lit, you just have to bring the other candles to that candle and light them off that candle. It's kind of how it is with us. We need to bring ourselves into proximity with other believers to really cause our flame to burn again. You're not alone. You're connected to an amazing family, and we're all in this together, and we will meet again, and we will be able to really cause that flame to burn again as we go out and be the light to others. Being connected to a community of believers is so critical. It's so critical. It's so critical that the writer to the Hebrews says that if you isolate yourself, and we're going to read that in a moment, if you isolate yourself, you're at the risk of being taken out by the devil. So I want you to read with me Hebrews 10, verse 24 to 27, as we look at this aspect now, a very important aspect. It says, "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries." All right, so the first part speaks about not neglecting meeting together. And the second part speaks of ongoing, willful, unrepentant, deliberate sin. In other words, it's a state where you become properly backslidden, if I can say it that way. So the first part is not neglecting meeting together. Let's talk about that. Now, this is not talking about gathering at a braai with Christian friends. That's great, but it's not talking about that. It's talking about gathering with a purposeful intention to help each other grow spiritually in a corporate worship service or in a connect group. It's talking about that. So in verse 24 to 27, we read it and we seem to see two themes here. In other words, there's two, what first appear to be two separate topics. The one is don't neglect meeting together, and the other is living in a place of ongoing deliberate sin. But the more I've read these verses, the more I've realized that they're actually not separate separate concepts at all. They are, in fact, joined together. I'm going to show you this. I'm going to read again from Hebrews 10:24, and I'm going to highlight the word that joins them. It says, "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries." Okay, I want to just highlight that one line. It says, for we go on sinning deliberately. For if we go on sinning deliberately. Now, I've underlined the word for because it's important. We are reading this particular passage. We're reading from the ESV, the English Standard Version, which is a very accurate literal translation of the original Greek. And so all the words here are important. All the words are there for a reason, because they convey something that was a truth that was within the original Greek. So the word for is being used here as a conjunction. A conjunction is a word that's used to connect sentences or clauses together. Let me give you an example. I cannot run any further, for I have hurt my leg. Now, you can interchange the conjunction for and the conjunction because, and it will mean the same thing. Let me read that sentence again. I cannot run any further, for I have hurt my leg. I cannot run any further because I have hurt my leg. It means the same thing. Now, what I want to do next is read the passage again from Hebrews 10, but replace the word for with the word because we've established that it means the same thing, but it just helps to open up the scripture a little bit more. Read it with me, Hebrews 10:24-27. "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Because if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and fury of fire that will consume the adversaries." Now, I've always read this passage as two separate concepts. In other words, the one is talking about, the one concept is don't neglect meeting together, and then it goes on to speak about living in this place of ongoing deliberate sin. But these two concepts are not separate. They are joined together. And together is the title of my message, togetherness. They're joined together. The conjunction pulls these two concepts together. Let me say it another way. Don't neglect meeting together and stirring each other up to love and good works, because if you do neglect this, you run the risk of ending up in a state of ongoing deliberate sinning and then expectation of judgment. I'm going to break it down even further and maybe simplify it without losing its meaning. Don't neglect meeting together, because if you do, you run the risk of backsliding. The ESV Study Bible summarizes these scriptures into a beautiful one-liner. It says this, it says, Christian perseverance is a community endeavor. Christian perseverance is a community endeavor. Again, highlighting the fact that these two concepts are joined. We need to be together. Now, I'm not saying that everyone is going to backslide because of the lockdown. I'm talking about the prolonged, willful disconnection from your church community. You didn't decide to stop attending church and connect group. You were forced to by the law in response to this pandemic. And the government was endeavoring to save lives and is saving lives. So this was not your decision to disconnect from your church family. And that means that when you're able to, again, you will go back to doing what you always did, and you will go back to church because you want to. And so to be clear, this scripture is talking about the willful disconnection from your church community. Okay, so I've made that clear, but I want to make something else clear. And what I'm about to say is really very, very important. It cannot just be you and your Bible and Jesus until he returns. I'll say that again. It cannot just be you and your Bible and Jesus until he returns. Biblically, that is not enough. Unless you're on a remote island with no one else in sight and no hope of ever being rescued, maybe a different story. But for everyone else, you need to be together with other believers. Togetherness must be a part of your Christian lifestyle. You remember the song, You in Your Small Corner and I in Mine? It's probably the most ridiculously unbiblical line ever written for a children's song. The rest of the song is great. It's just that line that bothers me. Perhaps I've misunderstood it, I don't know. But it cannot just be you in your small corner, you and Jesus and your Bible, and that's all going to be fine. You were created to do life together with other believers. That's how God created you. It's one of the ways the Lord enables you to persevere to the end and receive your eternal reward. It's with the help of other believers in community. You see, after being with Jesus and in the Word, and we know these things are important, I'm not downplaying the need for a quiet time. I'm not downplaying the need for personal prayer. I'm not downplaying the need to spend time in the Word. And we spent a whole year heating up the importance of drawing aside to the secret place. We're tracking on a Bible reading plan together. What I'm saying is this. Those things are important. What I'm saying is this, that when you leave your prayer closet and when you close your Bible, or when you minimize the app you're reading your Bible from, you need to make time in your lifestyle to be together with other believers. No matter how difficult it is, unless you're bedridden, of course, but no matter how difficult it is, make time. Don't forsake the gathering of the saints. It's regular and constant time with people. It's regularly and physically being with believers in an intentional way to disciple each other, to pray together, to worship together, to receive the teaching of the Word together. It's part of God's plan for us. And Zoom is not going to cut it forever. Thank the Lord for Zoom, but when all this is over, I don't want to be in another Zoom meeting for a very long time. I want to be in a real meeting with real people where I can make coffee for someone, where I can fist pump them for real, not send them an emoji fist pump. That's the kind of meeting I want to be in. In a real meeting where they might spill the coffee on me. Who cares? I'm gonna rejoice the next time someone spills coffee on me in a real meeting, because I'll be basking in the fact that we're actually in physical proximity for that to be able to happen. So I used to have a reputation for spilling coffee. People used to find me by following the coffee trail down the hallway, and they would follow the trail and find me at the end of that trail. And so I was thinking, maybe I'm going to start intentionally spilling coffee again. In fact, at our first real meeting, maybe I'm going to spill coffee on Pastor JJ on purpose and then watch him jump. And I'll be like, you see, it's you. It's really you. You're in the flesh. It's not just some computer screen. It's there. It's a real person. So the Church of Jesus needs physical proximity, not to spill coffee on each other, but to drink it together, or tea if you so please. But we're meant to be together. We're meant to sharpen each other. We're meant to pray for each other. We're meant to encourage each other. We're meant to lay hands on each other. We're meant to release words of wisdom and prophecy. The gifts are meant to flow when we're together. Without this, there is a gap in our Christian walk. The Bible tells me so. And I'm feeling that right now. And I'm sure you are too. The word says we are to stir up one another to love and to good works. In other words, something other than your own effort, something other than your individual effort is needed in order to stir up these love and good works in your life. You need fellow believers around you. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 7 says, a spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other, so we can help each other. This is important. God took all the spiritual gifts and he distributed them amongst all of us. And so no one person has all the gifts. And I believe that he did this so that it forces us to come together in order to live out and live in the fullness of our kingdom life as we bring all the gifts together, as we come together. So I'm preaching to the choir. 99% of you listening right now are probably regularly attending church. You're in a group, you're in a discipleship group. So why am I preaching to the choir? Because the choir needs to know right now that they're on track. I want you to be encouraged as you realize how important it's been that you made being together a life priority. You chose well. What you chose is without a doubt God's will for your life. Don't stop when this is over. Bring a friend to church. When we can meet again, bring a friend to church. Bring someone who hasn't been attending any church and get them to make a new life habit that could save their eternal lives. And if you're watching this and you've been avoiding church, because perhaps you've had a hurt in church and you've been avoiding church, I want to implore you, reconsider your decision. Jesus implores you through his word to reconsider your decision. It's so important to be together. I want to close with this final thought. We shine brighter when we're together. Matthew 5 verse 14 says, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. I want you to notice that Jesus doesn't say you're the light of the world like a candle on the hill. No, he says you're the light of the world, a city on a hill. He's talking about a community of light. We shine brighter when we're together. You will remember, I had a lot to say just a little while ago in this message, a lot to say about this song, You and Your Small Corner and I and Mine. What I want to do now is I want to redeem Susan Warner, whose song was first published in 1868. The song's actually called Jesus Bids Us Shine. And so it has three verses, and every verse ends in this line, you and your small corner and I and mine. But the rest of the song is so applicable. The rest of the song is so biblical that I want to read it to you. But if you don't mind, I'm going to leave out the small corner line. I don't understand that line. Let's leave it out for now. I'm sure Susan Warner had a reason for it. Let's leave it out and let's read it together. Jesus bids us shine. Jesus bids us shine with a pure, clear light, like a little candle burning in the night. In this world is darkness, so let us shine. Jesus bids us shine, first of all, for him. Well, he sees and knows it if our light grows dim. He looks down from heaven to see us shine. Jesus bids us shine then for all around, for all around. Many kinds of darkness in this world are found, sin and want and sorrow. So we must shine. So we must shine. We must shine together. One little candle burning on the hill is not going to be very attractive to the world. We must bring all of our little candles together, gather on that hill that Jesus spoke about, and we must combine our light so that it becomes a great city of lights, providing hope to the world around us, a city of light that will be so visible to everyone around that those living in the dark will come running to that hill of light. And we're going to be waiting there for them with open arms to welcome them in. It'd be a city of light where we as believers are literally basking in the glow of hundreds, if not thousands, of candles who are burning bright, who are walking out their Christian life together. Let's pray. Father, I pray for all those watching right now. Firstly, Lord, for those who were attending regularly, who were part of a church family and engaging and experiencing the togetherness that you speak of and that you want us to have. I pray, God, for those watching right now to be encouraged and really just reminded again of the fact that they chose that chose well, and that from after this pandemic, as we are able to meet again, God, that those of us who have been meeting regularly with believers and meeting, not forsaking the gathering of the saints, that we would continue to do that, Lord, but that we would do one extra thing. God, would you show us who around us needs to join us? God, there are people we know who serve you and love you, who are not in church, who are not part of a community of believers. And we know something's lacking because we've felt how this disconnection has caused a lack in us. And something's missing. And I pray, God, that you'd give us the courage to invite them to be part of a church family so that they can grow up and experience the fullness of all that you have in this kingdom life. I want to pray also now, Lord, for those who are not attending church. I know right now, God, there are those listening right now who've been hurt by church. And they carry offenses and hurts and they run deep. And they're disconnected from a church family. I want to pray, God, that you would, by your Spirit, move in those hearts right now. And I want to speak to you. In fact, I want to look into the camera lens for just a moment and speak to you if that's you. Please don't let a past hurt stop you from experiencing the fullness of what God wants for your life as you walk out your Christian life in a family of believers. I want to say, please do not let that offense stop you from walking into the fullness of God's kingdom life for you. I've just poured my heart out sharing how absolutely important and critical it is that you are part of a church family. I want to encourage you from the Lord. Jesus wants you to find a family. I want to encourage you to do that. So Father, we pray for everyone in that category. Would you cause that hurt to heal? And I really believe that for some of you, this word is for you now. And that is this, that the hurt you're trying to get over because of being in a church family, that hurt can only be healed when you get back into a church family. And there are people that God's going to place in your path in those church families that are going to enable you to overcome the hurt and to move on. So, Father, I pray your blessing upon everyone in that category in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, for your goodness. We thank you that we can meet. And we pray, God, would you cause this pandemic to end soon, God, so that we can meet together again. We are longing to be together. I'm longing to be together with the saints. We pray for a miracle in that, in your hand, to bring that calm again, God, so we can do what we love to do, to worship together, to praise together, to sing together, to hear your word together. We're longing for those times again, God. And when we're able to, we're going to do it again. And we're going to keep doing it till the day you return. In Jesus' name, amen. We've put together a choir item now, a social distancing choir item. And we're going to play out with a song. I know you're going to be blessed. Remember, we're meant to be together.
That was such a special item. And just like we said in the beginning, there's been at least 70 people that have been involved in the making of the service. And can you think that every one of them is in a different house around the city and around the cities? So it's been awesome. Thank you for that. Harvest, hope you're going to go and have a nice cup of coffee and with your family. Maybe phone someone that's been on your heart. Encourage those that are in our church family, because that's what unity is. And pray that you're going to have a blessed week, and that no matter what happens, you know that God goes before you. Know that we're praying for you, Harvest, and that the best is yet to come. We love you, Harvest. Look forward to seeing you next week. God bless.
I will cry to the God of Abraham. I will call to the rock on which I stand. To the only great I am, great God.
I will trust in the voice that calms the storm.